the point about points is that our idea of points, like when we go like this, we go, here's my point, 3.5. I'm going to move it over here. Here's 3.5, right? That's wrong. That's not 3.5. If that was really 3.5, we wouldn't be able to see a thing. A point is not a small, tiny circle. That's just a representation. And what it does is it gives us the wrong sense of how things are. Like if you remove a point, okay, and if it was in your mind of a ruler, you should be able to like hold it up to the sun and see a little bit of sunlight shine through. But that's wrong. It's impossible, because if that was the case, we'd be removing a little bit of length and then we wouldn't have one. So this is pushing our notions of what maths is, which is why I love it. I love this stuff.
But your whole premise, your discussion here is how do we measure numbers?
Yeah.
Who wants to measure numbers? Who said numbers were measurable in the first place? Why is this a problem for you? Like,
why is this a problem?
You don't measure numbers. Numbers are what you do the measuring with.
Why is this a problem? Because we are using stuff that we haven't proved. We're using naive notions of measure. That's why that's a problem. We're making assumptions. This almost broke maths, where I'm going with this. It almost broke maths. And that sounds like I'm being really full on, but it's absolutely true. And I don't know if I'm going to be able to show you the exact reason why it almost broke maths. But what I'm talking about here, I can tell you right now what this led to. This led to the computer, what I'm talking about. But the hair standing up on the back of my neck when I talk about this. That's how exciting this is. It's so exciting that people started going, oh, I know how to measure. You take one, you take the final, you take the initial. Sure, that's all right. Well, what happens when you remove points? What happens when you remove an infinite number of points? Let's just think about it like this, okay? Let's go from 0 to 12. Okay, so the length of that is 12. So 12 takes 0 is 12. That's the length.
Yep.
So then I'm going to wrap it around a clock face. Oops, that's not a very good clock. It's more like an egg. So there's 12 there, 9, okay?
Yep.
And the reason why I want to show you this is because now I'm going to mark out every fraction. So it's almost like every single way that you could divide up time in a way that would be sensible. I'm actually going to put holes, tiny little holes, all around the clock face. Now this is where I'm hopefully going to break your brain. Because now I've removed every single fraction and a segment of number line. And the fact that I've made it 12 doesn't matter. What's the length of this line now? Remember, the real number line contains numbers other than fractions, because most of the real number line are transcendental numbers. What's kind of crazy is that in this case, though, between any two fractions, right? So between any two fractions, so let's just say here between 0 and 1, right? Between 0 and 1, you've removed half, yeah? But you've also removed a quarter and an eighth. And a 16th, and a 32th, right, keeps going all the way down. So between any two fractions, there's another fraction. And between any two fractions, there's another fraction. So in maths, they call it dense. It's dense with numbers. So it should make you feel a little bit uneasy that you might be making a mistake. What we can play with is how many points there are. So what you can do is you can kind of count out all the numbers, right? This is a fraction here, so you could go, it's this on this, whatever it is, so that's 2 on 1. This is 2 on 2, this is 2 on 3, this is 2 on 4, etc., etc. So each point represents a fraction, and you've kind of covered every single possible fraction that there is, right? And what we're trying to do is we're trying to show that this, all the fractions, are countable or listable. So this is a really great thing, and what you do is you draw the snake. So you draw the snake like so, and you draw it like that, okay? And you're basically going, I can create a list of all the fractions. If we know that we can list all these points, okay, let's make a list of them. So let's talk about all the fractions. Let's call it F. All the fractions between 0 and 12. So, you know, there'll be half will be in there, you know, two-thirds will be in there, four-thirds will be in there, whatever. If that's listable, let's measure the length of all of them. So the length... What's the length of half? Well, that's 0. What's the length of 2/3? Well, that's 0. What's the length of 4/3? Well, that's 0. Boop, 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 boop. So I've got an infinite sum of 0. So 0 added to itself infinitely many times? 0. So it's because of the number, in a sense, the number, even though it's infinite, and infinite really isn't a number, but the fact that the type of infinite it is, a countable infinite, and it's listable, means that if we remove a countable number of points, a listable number of points, we haven't changed the length, because the length of all those points have to be zero.
If I remove your feelings,
yeah,
your size won't change. Just like if I remove the numbers, the infinitely small abstract numbers from a line, the length of the line doesn't change. Numbers don't have volume or size, so they, because they're just an abstract thing, they're a describing word. Are we starting to come towards philosophy here?
No, I'm a bit weirded out by you removing my feelings. Without my feelings, I can't do maths. Because it's all very emotional. This is the thing is that you're putting a nice analogy on something when this is already an analogy. The problem is that humans and mathematicians, we are really analogizing. Even the maths that you see is, in a sense, it's an analogy. Just like how Roman numbers was like, they thought they had it. They thought, yeah, we know numbers. They're never going to change. We're in charge. They're never going to change. And they've changed. And it's because there's been a better way to represent numbers. And I think what I love about this is that we draw a line. Well, first of all, you can't draw a line. It's impossible. It's just a very, very thin rectangle. And you draw points. That's ridiculous. You can't draw points. But there you go. We draw points. And then suddenly we go, oh, I know what to do there because, you know, I know how to use a ruler. You do final, take initial. Fantastic. Oh, suddenly something makes sense in maths. Boom. It doesn't make sense. Suddenly you're confronted with these conundrums of like, what happens when I take away a point? Well, nothing, because there is no next point. Like, there is no whole per se. And so when you try thinking about it, you actually have to start questioning every single assumption. And this is where this led into an analysis of set theory. What assumptions were mathematicians making about maths? Very heavy questions. What mathematicians were able to do, should I go here? Okay, I'll go there. What mathematicians were able to do were able to create sets of numbers that you couldn't measure. And it was linked to these kinds of ideas. So you're actually picking all the guy who did it was a guy called Giuseppe Vitali. And he came up with this idea of consider the solid segment between 0 and 1 and consider all the fractions. But then he kind of considered every single copy of that in 0 to 1. And what that means is very complicated. It's called a partition. But basically, he found all these different copies of it. Then he just took one point from every single copy. And that set, you could not measure. There was no way that you could get a sensible answer. Getting zero is a sensible answer. This gave no sensible answer. It gave a contradiction. You look at it one way, you get one answer. You look at the other way, you get a different answer. That's a problem. Because I thought I knew how to measure. I thought I knew how to use a ruler. I thought I knew maths. And this guy realized that there were these sets that you couldn't measure. And that caused massive problems. Mathematicians were very, very upset. The thing that I realized when I studied this is that it made me question what I knew about numbers. So my life I see as a timeline of discovery of numbers. Why not? You know, I discovered numbers the way watching Sesame Street or whatever you do, and you get a sense of, oh yeah, one, two, fractions, you start getting your head around these things. But suddenly when you come to the point where you think about how numbers are related and points and decimal expansions, all that sort of stuff, you start going, wow, 3 is weird. Like, I thought I knew 3, but 3 is very strange. The abstraction of these numbers are very strange. And what it really drove me to is to question everything. You have to question everything in maths. There's so much that we bring in from the outside world, which just gives you the wrong idea. We thought we knew measure because measurement was about numbers. So a ruler, you know, you could go, there's a ruler, there's a real ruler, there's a mathematical ruler. It looks like a ruler. Surely I can't go wrong with this. But what you can do, the sorts of sets that you can make, the kind of removal of points, you're really doing things there's no way you could do in reality. No way at all you could do in reality. So, yeah, so this is the stuff. And then exploring these things, that's what really gets... I mean, like, people actually started to question reasoning out of this, how we reason. And it actually did lead to the computer. Like, it actually led... Alan Turing was the guy who was trying to reformulate some of the questions that came out of this. He started reformulating Kurt Gödel's work, and out of that came the Turing machine, which is, for all intents and purposes, the first computer. Might not be exactly, but anyway, he's the guy who kind of came up with it. And they were just trying to think. They were trying to go, how do you think? Like, what are the assumptions we make? So yeah, so for me, this was like the crowning glory of my mathematical education, was really getting to the bottom of, like, you know, if I was a musician, it's like, what is music? Like, what is it? Why does it make you feel a certain way?
But it sounds like your conclusion is, we don't know.
What don't we know?
What numbers are?
I would love that. Because I'm assuming it's going to be completely incomprehensible to me.